Welcome everyone, and thank you for joining us for our A-Levels virtual open event. I'm Tracy, and I'm Head of Academy for A-Levels.
And I am Sotiri, and I'm the Assistant Academy Manager for A-Levels.
So how this webinar is going to work is that Sotiri and I will share our information with you. We can't see you, but you should be able to see us alongside any information we share on screen. We and other attendees can't hear you. However, you will be able to ask questions throughout the webinar using the Q&A feature. If you're using a computer, this will be at the bottom of your screen. If you're using a mobile device, tap the screen and this will appear at the top. Someone will either answer your questions live or answer it on the Q&A feed. Ask your questions as we go along. We have opportunities throughout the presentation to answer as many as we can live. Please be aware that your name will appear next to your question, but you can click to ask your questions anonymously. We are using polls during the open event this evening, and these are anonymous, so get involved as much as you can. We are recording this webinar, and you will receive an email with the link to the recording. This will also be available on the Harlow College website. Firstly, we're going to share a short video with you to show you around our campus and introduce you to the college, and also includes a message from our principal, Karen Spencer.
Hi, I'm Karen Spencer, and I'm the principal at both Harlow College and Stansted Airport College. It's a pleasure to welcome you to our virtual open event. We're really sorry we can't see you in person, but this is an opportunity for you to have a look around and ask some questions. We've got lots of teams talking to you this evening about the fabulous resources and facilities we have here at the college. They're also going to tell you a little bit about why you should choose Harlow College. Please take time to look around, ask questions, and we hope to see you in person in the near future.
Brilliant. Right, so let's begin. Let's get our first slide up. Right, so we're going to start with looking at what subjects we offer here at Harlow College in the sixth form. So you can see we've got a vast range of subjects available there. The subjects in black are the ones that we have been offering for a while. Economics, we are hoping to offer this September if we get enough learners interested in enrolling onto it. So what we would ask learners to do is in their application for Harlow College, and or at interview, just to make us aware that economics is something that they are interested in studying. With that, we would then say to learners, just have a backup subject just in case it doesn't run. Next slide, please. So our A-level subjects can be combined with BTEC Law. BTEC Law is a subject that we run within the A-level department. It's not designed to combine with any other program but A-levels. It comes in the size of an AS in the first year and then an A-level in the second year, and that's as large as it goes. So you can see that it's been designed to be combined with other subjects in order to make a full program. It's a combination of coursework and exams. So in the first year, there are two units, one exam-based, one coursework-based, and the same in the second year, one exam-based unit and one coursework-based unit. In addition to BTEC Law, to go alongside A-levels, we also offer the Extended Project Qualification, EPQ. This is a one-year programme and it is equivalent to an AS. So it's not designed to replace an A-level subject. It's intended to enhance the A-level programme. It's what learners would take alongside their A-levels and BTEC Law if they choose to take it. Extended Project Qualification is where we teach learners research skills, and they use these skills to complete a project on the topic of their choosing. Because it's focused on research skill development, it's highly prized by universities in particular, and they do like to see EPQ on applications for programs such as those at Oxford and Cambridge, and for things such as veterinary and medicine. Next slide, please. So the big question, what are our entry requirements to get onto A-levels? So the starting point for all learners is the same. We would like learners to get an average minimum score of 5 from their 7 best GCSEs. This 7 needs to include at least one English, but it can be both, maths, and at least one science. We then have specific entry requirements for each subject. This is based around the skills and the knowledge that we would want the learners to have acquired at GCSE. So for many of our subjects, the key skill we want learners to demonstrate is the ability to write, because they're heavily essay-based programs. So these would be subjects such as geography, history, BTEC Law, media, photography, politics, and sociology. Interestingly, you don't need to have studied any of those subjects at GCSE in order to study them at A level. So as I'm highlighting there, the key skill is to be able to write, so a 5 in English literature or language, and then real enthusiasm for the subject. If you want to study English language, we would like you to get a 5 in GCSE English language. If you want to study English literature, we would like a 5 in English literature. Next slide, please. Now we're getting on to subjects that need a slightly different entry requirement. So business requires a 5 in one of your Englishes, but then we would also like a 5 in maths. And this is accounting for the amount of maths that learners will come across in the syllabus. Psychology is similar. We would like a 5 in one of the Englishes because of the essays involved in the programme. Then we would like a 5 in maths or science. And this is because there is quite a bit of statistics in psychology. There is also quite a lot of biology and chemistry. So we can support learners if they're slightly weaker in maths or science, but we would need them to have at least one of those, to be struggling in both maths and science and wanting to take psychology, we feel is too much for that programme. For French, we would like a learner to get a 7 in GCSE French. In art, we would like a learner to get a 5 in an art-based programme. So this might be art at GCSE, but it might be something else like textiles, DT, that sort of thing. Learners might be asked to provide a portfolio, and if learners are worried about whether what they've done at GCSE is appropriate to study A-level art, they can talk to the art teacher and we can discuss that at interview. For philosophy, we would like a learner to get a score of 6 in both GCSE English and maths. Again, we don't mind which English. EPQ, as I said, this is a subject that's for those learners that want to enhance their A-level programme. And we are aiming for the learners who are getting higher grades in their GCSE. So we would like learners to have got a 7 in one of their Englishes and an average score of 7 from their best seven GCSEs. For computer science, we would like a learner to have maths at a score of 6 and then a computer science based program at a 6. So this could be computer science. Learners might have done a BTEC IT, something like that. Next slide, please. So on to our sciences. So this gets a little bit complicated because it depends on whether a learner has done triple science, so they've done the three sciences separately as GCSEs, or whether they've done combined science. So if a learner has done combined science to study biology, chemistry, or physics, we would like them to get a 6-6. To study biology with triple science, we would like you to get a 6 in biology and then a 6 in one other of your sciences and a 5 in maths. To study chemistry with triple science, we'd like a 6 in chemistry and a 6 in one other, and then a 6 in maths. And for physics, we would like a 6 in physics, a 6 in one other science, and then a 7 in maths. So the increase in the required maths grade there at GCSE, moving from biology to chemistry to physics, demonstrates the amount of maths that learners will come across in those A-level subjects. So again, we're focusing on the skills and the knowledge that learners need in order to be successful on those subjects. In order to study maths at at A-level, we need a 7 in GCSE maths, and there is an entrance test. So this is done on the day of enrolment. It's GCSE level, but it's particularly focusing on whether learners understand maths rather than just learning it by rote. A-level maths is not a subject that you can just memorize. There needs to be an understanding of the mathematical calculations, and we need to know that for the learners, there is that innate ability. For learners who want to study further maths, they need to get an 8 in GCSE maths, and they must do A-level maths alongside it. Next slide, please. Now, it is possible for a learner to do A-levels at Harlow College without getting either their English or their maths at the minimum score of 4 as required by the government. So if we look at these examples, it will explain why. And it comes back to what I've been saying about learners being allowed onto their programs for which they're showing they possess the skills and the knowledge to take. So for example, if we have a humanities learner, so this is a learner who's very good at writing. They've managed to get their average score of 5 from their 7 best GCSEs, and they've got at least one of their Englishes at a score of 5 or above, but their GCSE maths is, say, a score of 3, so they haven't got the minimum government requirement of a 4. They can study humanities subjects, so for example, English language, history, geography, that sort of thing. So there you can see a learner could take certain A-level subjects alongside doing their GCSE maths. Likewise, we might have a learner who's very much science and maths based. They're strong in a STEM subject, so they also have their average score of 5 from their 7 best GCSEs. They've got good maths and science subjects that allow them to progress onto A-level science and maths, but they've got a GCSE score for English at a 3. Now, they can study STEM subjects, so the science and math subjects at A level, and then they would do their English GCSE alongside their A level program. So every year we will have a few learners who will fall into these two examples. So again, there's a real emphasis that learners coming on to A levels, we're very much focusing on, have they got the skills and knowledge for the particular A-level subjects they're interested in studying. So not achieving that minimum score of 4 in English or maths does not necessarily preclude a student from going on to A-levels. Next slide, please. Right, let's have a look to see if we've got any questions that we can go through here. So, we've got a question. Are any of our coursework, are any of them coursework-based subjects? So I've already mentioned law, our BTEC, which is half coursework, half exam. But absolutely, there are A-level subjects that are coursework based. So art and photography would be the two subjects that are most obviously fully coursework based, although they do have coursework exams. So these are long exams spread over a couple of days. So we're talking several hours of exam based assessment. But also subjects such as English literature and English language, there's coursework, history. So these subjects, geography, they've got their coursework elements. So we introduce the coursework in the first year, but then learners are focusing on completing that coursework in the second year. So for subjects like English literature, English language, history, geography, the coursework element makes up 20% of the overall grade that the learner achieves. What else have we got here? Are we going to be required to wear a uniform? Right, we are going to move on to this towards the end of the presentation, but just to confirm, no, you will not be asked to use a uniform, and we will we'll explain in what ways we're also different from secondary school sixth forms in addition to that. Okay, so on that note, I'm going to hand over to Satiri, and he's going to take you through a bit more of the presentation.
Thank you, Tracy. Let's have a look at what a timetable looks like for the average A-level student. In your screens, you can see all the subjects we offer, and each subject comes under an option. We have five options, option A being Monday, and option E being Friday. So an option for each day of the week. The option tells you also when you have your morning session. We have two sessions per subject per week, one morning followed by an afternoon session 2 days later. So for example, if you study biology, which is the first subject under option A, you will study biology on Monday morning, but also on Wednesday afternoon. This will be 2 3-hour long sessions. I think we need to go to the next slide, please, so we can see different examples so you can understand better how our timetable works. This student, for instance, studies politics, sociology, law, and business. As you can see, politics, which is a subject in option A, is taught on Monday morning and also Wednesday afternoon. And if we look at sociology, which is taught on Tuesday morning, it is also taught on Thursday afternoon. What you also see here is a session on Thursday morning, which is a free, if you like, period for the learner. And on that session, the learner must attend a tutorial and workshop. This is an opportunity for them to discuss their individual learning plan, as well as targets and specific themes that the college decides. And of course, have the opportunity to work on assignments and homework. This is part of the learner's timetable. There is a register and there is a teacher facilitating the session. So it is compulsory to attend. Next slide, please. This learner seems to be very strong in humanities if you look at the combination of subjects with politics, sociology, and law. But if you pay attention to Tuesday afternoon, you see that they have to do GCSE maths. That indicates that this particular learner did not achieve the minimum score of 4 or above for their GCSE maths. For that reason, they have to attend maths and take the exam, hopefully in November, if not the following June, until they get that 4. Next slide, please. Now, this is a very common question that we've been asked a lot. Should I take 3 or 4 A-levels? Before I answer this question, I think we need to ascertain what is the benefit of studying 4 A-levels. If you consider that most universities for most degrees require learners to attain 3 full A-levels or the equivalent, there is little benefit in studying 4. Courses at Oxford, Cambridge, as well as medicine and veterinary science also require 3A levels. There is some compromise here. Those who want to study for 4A levels may be willing to study for the extended project qualification, the EPQ that Tracy mentioned earlier on, during the first year in order to strengthen their application. In fact, here we have a quote from Cambridge University. And as you can see that those who study for 4A levels will not normally be at an advantage compared with those taking 3. However, competitive applicants for STEM courses often have further maths as a fourth subject. And that quote is from Cambridge University. Next slide, please. What we ask learners to do is to consolidate their efforts, put all their energy and enthusiasm in the 3A levels they want to study, and make sure they get high grades on those 3, which are far preferable to lower grades spread over 4 subjects. Having said this, the number of subjects a learner can study will be discussed at interview and enrollment. So if you're really thinking about doing 4, I suggest we pick this up at interview and we look at every application on a case-by-case basis. Next slide, please. Another common question we get from applicants is whether they can combine A levels with a BTEC. Again, as it was mentioned just a few minutes ago, one of the very common combinations we offer, it is 2A levels alongside BTEC law. BTEC law is something we offer within the department. However, historically, we have offered A levels with vocational courses in health and social care, engineering, and sport. Whether this is something we will be able to offer you depends on the timetables. So, compatibility between the A levels timetable and the vocational area timetable. And of course, again, as I said before, we look at this request on a case-by-case basis, and we try to accommodate as much as we can in order to individualize your study program. Next slide, please. Okay, let's see if we've got any questions in the chat and see if I can answer any of those. Do we know the requirements for the new A-level in economics? Yes, for economics, we would need a 6 in maths and English. Could I take computer science if I didn't take it at GCSE, but I learn about computer science on online courses? The important point here, and this is what I'd like you to take with you tonight, is that for computer science, primarily, we're looking at maths. We would like applicants to have studied that at GCSE, but if the maths is strong, and I'm talking about a 6, then we will look at that application favorably. Okay, and I think now on that note, I think we're ready to move to the next slide. So I will pass you over to Tracy.
Right, so progression, what happens after your A level? So we look at progression from the very beginning of a learner's program here at Harlow College. Most learners will progress onto university. So we've got here example of where our graduates from last year progressed onto. So we had many that went to Russell Group universities, the top 24 universities in the country, such as Cambridge, Edinburgh, Bristol, Imperial, to study a real range of subjects. So we had the classics in there, medicine, veterinary medicine. But we also have a growing interest in areas such as aerospace, engineering, and learners also looking to study subjects totally different to what they've done in their A levels. So this year just gone, we had a learner progress on to studying Korean alongside international relations. So their learners are really exploring what their options are with regards to their university degrees, recognizing that actually they don't necessarily need to have studied the subject already at A level in order to study it at university. So from the very beginning, we're looking with learners about what their progression opportunities are, with a big focus on university, because that is where most learners are going to go. And we need learners to be thinking about, right, what are the entry requirements for those degrees or those universities that I'm setting my heart on? So we need learners having that goal of those entry requirements. Next slide, please. So yes, absolutely, most of our learners will go to university. However, we've got a lot more learners now exploring different ways of getting a university degree. So higher apprenticeships are an option for learners who want to get their university degree, but don't necessarily want to go to university. So a higher apprenticeship is where you have a job and you do your degree alongside your job whilst you're working. So, the lovely thing about doing the higher apprenticeship is that your company, your employer, pays for your tuition costs. So unlike learners who have gone to university, who will incur a lot of debt, the average debt for university is £54,000, and that's your tuition fees as well as your living costs. Learners who are doing the higher apprenticeship will get their degree paid for them. Because they're an employee, because they have a job, they will be paid to do that job and then get their degree alongside it. So in fact, they're earning whilst they're getting their degree. So we encourage our learners to look at apprenticeships alongside applying for university. And many of our learners apply for both. And you can do that, that's absolutely fine. Because these learners are applying for higher apprenticeships, so there is a degree attached to it, that means it's got entry requirements. So it's gonna have a conditional offer, just like going to university has a conditional offer. So certain grades the learner needs to have achieved in their A level. Now this means that they won't know if they have secured their university places or their a higher apprenticeship until results day. So it gives the learners quite a lot of time to reflect, to think which pathway is going to suit me better. Am I better at going the university route and do I want that experience and recognizing I'm going to incur that debt? Or actually would I be better off going the higher apprenticeship route? By the time results day comes around, a learner will have made up their mind, but we support them with the whole decision process, talking to them about the pros and cons and how they feel about each of their options. So you can see there some examples of different apprenticeship pathways that our learners have taken. So solicitor apprenticeships are becoming much more common. A few years ago, there were only one or two available. There's many more higher apprenticeships now for learners to become qualified solicitors in the same amount of time it becomes to go, become a qualified solicitor going the university and law school route. So last year we had a learner secure an apprenticeship at Evershed Sutherland Global Law Practice based in Cambridge. We also have learners thinking about going straight into careers where they would otherwise have to go to university. So we're seeing more learners being getting interested in going the nursing apprenticeship route. So we've got learners who are training to become nurses via Princess Alexandra Hospital during apprenticeships then, rather than incurring debt to become qualified. And also another growing field that is catching the interest of learners is cybersecurity. So learners do not necessarily need to have studied computer science or even maths at A level in order to qualify for cybersecurity apprenticeships. These companies are willing to train students from the ground up, and the apprenticeship opportunities with these are amazing. And many of them are working with government agencies because obviously we recognize how important cybersecurity is for national security. Next slide, please. So what can learners do alongside their main programme? So just like sit forms in a secondary school, we offer a range of activities that learners can do alongside their A-level programme. We've already mentioned the extended project qualification, and we've recognised that this is an add-on to A-levels, it's not instead of. In addition to their main programme, all learners on A-levels are expected to do work experience. So we would want a minimum of 30 hours work experience. That's a week's worth of work experience on their programme. For some learners, this is to strengthen their application for university or for going into a job or an apprenticeship. But for some learners, it's because they're not too sure what they'd like to do as a job. Maybe their understanding of what a job involves is a little bit unrealistic. They need to get into the workplace. They need to try that career out to see, actually, is it what I expected? Some career pathways, as I've said, require learners to do work experience, and it's part of the entry conditions. So, for example, veterinary and medicine really would want learners to have particular work experience to go into those courses at university. In addition to getting, for example, 30 hours of work experience, or the degree might require more than that, we also encourage learners to do volunteering. So this is in addition to the work experience placement that we would like learners to have. So if you think back to the timetable that Satiri was talking you through earlier, you'll have noticed that there were half days there where learners didn't necessarily have a timetabled lesson. So because we don't have our free slots as little 1 hour lessons scattered throughout the week, we've consolidated them into a block. What that means is a learner can, for example, get a half day of work experience. This has worked out particularly useful for learners who want to get onto those very competitive courses like veterinary and medicine. So with those courses, in addition to the 30 hours or more of blocks of work experience that are required for those degree conditional offer entries, we would suggest to learners start doing half day volunteering. You can do that throughout the term. So for example, they can do a half day on a Monday if that's when they've got a free. If they're interested in medicine, they could do that, for example, in a care home. If they're interested in going into primary school education, they could do it in a primary school. So there's lots of different ways that learners can use their free time to strengthen their application. And it doesn't have to mean confining work experience to the holiday periods. They can also sort of embed it into their main program. So this way, we feel that our unique timetable that we've created is enabling learners to use their time much more efficiently and effectively for their progression. We have all the same kinds of clubs and societies that you would expect in a secondary school sit form, obviously not running at the moment because of COVID, but we're looking forward to be able to get these back up and running again soon. So, for example, we've got the kinds of sports clubs that learners would want to be getting involved in, so football, rugby, those sorts of things. We've also got the leisure zone next door, so we run different kinds of sporting activities there, so for example, trampolining, and learners also get discounted membership to the leisure zone. So some learners just want to get their membership and then use the pool or do the classes or go into the exercise rooms. We do have a gym on campus as well that learners can use when it's not being utilised by the sports students. In addition to the sporting activities, we also have more academic clubs that the students can join. So, for example, we have a coding club that we encourage learners to get involved with. So all our learners get iPads when they start at the college, and they become really au fait at using them within their classes with all the different apps that they have. But as we know, IT is important in most careers nowadays, and being able to code is a really good skill to have. So we encourage learners, even those not doing, for example, computer science as an A-level, to get involved in coding if that's something that interests them. We also have a number of academic competitions that we encourage learners to get involved with, and these look excellent on applications for university and apprenticeships. So, for example, the Formula One in Schools competition, which is a competition where learners in teams of three design and then build models to then race their model cars that they then race against other students, teams from other schools. So a couple of years ago, we had an A-level team, or last year it was, and they won the regional competition and placed, but unfortunately didn't win the national competition, which was a bit of a shame because they were then going to be able to take their model to Dubai to represent Great Britain in the international competition. But those students, all three of them, then progressed on to excellent universities to study engineering. So they were all really keen in that subject. They were using their skills and knowledge to then create their car, their model. We also have STEM Olympiads. So these are science and maths based competitions, different levels that learners can get involved with. They start off with learners doing competition tasks here on campus. And then if they're really successful, they get invited to the regional competitions, which are normally based either in London or in Cambridge. We love going on visits and trips or having speakers coming to the college. Obviously, these sorts of things have had to go on hold at the moment because of COVID, except where we've been able to get speakers to talk to our learners via Microsoft Teams. So we've been able to do it over the internet, which has really meant we've been able to keep that experience ongoing for learners. So in some cases, our trips and visits and speakers are generic. So what that means is that it's not subject specific and any learner can get involved in those experiences. And sometimes they are very much subject specific. So for example, law and government and politics, going to the Houses of Parliament or going to the Crown Court to see cases being heard. So we have a number of different ways in which learners can have their program enhanced by the different extracurricular activities that we put on. Every cohort, we love to give an opportunity to go on an international trip. Again, that's obviously had to go on hold. For the last couple of trips, we've gone to Ghana, where we've worked in a local school in Ghana and worked with street children. And the next trip we plan to do is to go to Greece to get involved with turtle conservation. So we spoke to the learners and asked them what they were interested in doing. And that's where they, you know, with the very much in the forefront in the media, the concerns about sea pollution, ocean pollution, plastics, and the impact it's having on sea life, the learners said they'd be very keen to get involved in something along those lines. So that's why we're planning on turtle conservation for our next international trip. We also have an opportunity for learners to get involved in our ambassador scheme. So these have a variety of different ways that learners can get involved. So we've got our digital ambassadors. So this is where we utilize the learners' digital competence that we talked about. Where they will be demonstrating the wonderful activities that learners do using their iPads and the online learning that they do both in class and outside of class, often to visiting schools, and that's also been internationally. So people have come from abroad to try and understand how IT and apps can be used effectively within the class, but also outside of the class, particularly to enhance revision for exams. The other ambassador scheme is where learners represent the college at different events. So for example, open evening, when we're allowed to do open evenings at college, many of the visitors are shown around by our ambassadors. Learners can also apply to be part of the Board of Governors. We always want learner representatives to help us make the college as strong as possible and as effective as possible with each year. Next slide, please. Right, so let's have a look and see what other questions we have got to answer here. So, right, what have we got? So quite a lot of them I think I have answered. I think we're pretty good with the questions that we've got. Oh, could I take computer science if I didn't take it at GCSE, but I learned about computer science on online courses? So I think Satiri touched on this one earlier. The key one we're looking at is maths with that subject. And again, it's where we're saying to learners, think about the skills you need and talk to us at interview. And then we will look at that on a case-by-case basis. When do you plan on going to Greece? Well, it's not going to be this summer because unfortunately there's just too much uncertainties and not having the learners yet on site, although we're very excited about having our learners back next week. So that will be what we will be planning for the summer 2022. We will be planning to do that. Obviously, everything will be COVID permitting, and we will look at what the situation is with COVID before we commit to anything. But it would be fabulous if we could take the learners next summer. Right, on that note, I'm going to hand over to Satiri, who's going to talk to you about what it's like studying at the college.
Okay, I think I can answer this question very briefly, but of course I will explain the process. So the simple answer here is apply now. How to do that? You need to go on our website, or you can use our interactive digital full-time guide. You need to select the course you're interested. Then obviously, you know, click apply, complete the application. Please do not panic about your personal statement. What we need you to do is to apply for at least one A level so we can get your application in the system. You will get confirmation and an interview date. At the moment, all interviews are conducted by telephone or Microsoft Teams. Under normal circumstances, we meet students here at the college, or we visit the local school and we interview there. Interviews are a brilliant opportunity to meet us, and of course for us to meet you. They're an opportunity to discuss your subjects, to discuss possible progression opportunities, careers, university courses, of course, answer your questions, find more about the college, reassure you about your future studies. What I need you to know is that throughout this process, we will work together and we'll make sure that we find a course that is right for you. Next slide, please. Now, I think this is the exciting part of the evening. I'm going to read out some myths about the college and about studying A-levels here at the college. And then you will be given the opportunity to tell us whether the myth is actually true or false. So this is the statement. Learners will get better results if they study in a secondary sixth form compared to attending Harlow College. What we'd like you to do is to tell us what you think about the statement. Do you think the statement is true or false? You have 20 seconds. So please tell us what you think. Let these votes keep coming in. Okay. Wow. Okay, that's a very decisive response. Excellent. Thank you. Let's have a look at the answer. Next slide, please. Of course, the statement is false. When we consider the starting point of each learner, learners here at the college do as well and often better compared to many other schools in the local area. And this information is calculated as student progress score or value added. Now, how is this value being generated? The score is generated by looking at how well the learners do compared to the target grade they have for each A-level subject, which is generated by the government and is based on the learner's GCSE results. So this is actually a figure that tells you how far you have progressed since you came to us from your school with your GCSE grades. Next slide, please. Learners at Harlow College sixth form are left to just get on with it instead of having the level of support they would get in a secondary school sixth form. So there is the poll is live. Tell us what you think. Is this true or false? Okay, so let's have a look at the results. Few more people voting at the moment. Okay, let's see. Okay, I think that's it's pretty clear. I think it looks like you know the answer already. So of course, the claim is false. Learners here at the college get up to 6 hours of teacher contact time a week for each of the subject, something between 5 and 6 hours. And if you recall the information from the timetable I showed you a while ago, you get 2 3-hour long sessions per week, one morning and one afternoon session per subject. These longer sessions, the 3-hour sessions, allow us what we call deep learning. So they are an opportunity for us to actually delve into the subject and explore, question, examine, challenge. So in that sense, you get quality time as well as quantity. We also operate an open door policy to the staff room, and the managers are also willing to see students without appointments and address their concerns as and when these arise. Next slide, please. Right, studying at Harlow College sixth form is far more relaxed than studying in a secondary school sixth form. And there's your opportunity again to tell us what you think. Is this claim true or false? Okay, I think probably got most of the votes in. Okay, true, right. Interestingly, and I'm glad there is a bit of a mixed picture here. Interestingly, this claim is both true and false. So you probably write whatever you answered. Let's see how we are different from a school. First of all, something that Tracy, I think, explained tonight, there is no uniform policy. Okay, so straight away, that makes things more relaxed, more personal. Learners call us by our first names. We're not sirs, certainly I'm not. We operate an open door policy, and of course, the managers, as well as here, willing to help and assist learners. Now, at the same time, and I think this is for everyone to be reassured, we take your education seriously. We are very, very concerned about your progression. We're very concerned about your progress within the year. And to make sure that you're progressing, we need to see you here at the college. So all sessions are compulsory. All homework needs to be completed. And like in a school, we have parent siblings twice in a year, usually in term one and in term two. And we also send reports at home, sometime towards the end of the second term, beginning of third. So yes, we can be relaxed, but we can also be professional and effective. Next slide, please. I think I will let Tracy answer that. Thank you, Tracy.
Yeah, absolutely. So fourth myth, learners studying at Harlow College sixth form don't have the same progression opportunities as a learner studying in a second school sixth form. So what do you think about that statement? Is that true Or is that false? Do you think learners have more progression opportunities if they study in a secondary school sixth form? So let's have a look at these results. Right, so resounding voting for false, that statement is incorrect, which is absolutely true. It is false. So we offer excellent guidance for learners from the very beginning of their year one, as I mentioned earlier when I talked about progression. So we, from the very beginning, encourage learners to think about what their progression pathway is going to be. For most learners, as I mentioned, at each university, we've got more now exploring higher apprenticeships, but we also allow learners to find out about other learning opportunities. So for example, HNCs, HNDs that we offer here, or other local colleges offer, and certain professional qualifications that learners might want to move on to do, such as accounting or law qualifications, but also into employment. Next slide, please. All right, our last myth. So learners studying at Harlow College sixth form won't have the same opportunities to do extracurricular activities compared to being in a secondary sixth form. So what do you think to that statement? Is that true or is that false? Do learners have more opportunities for extracurricular activities in a secondary school sixth form? So a few more seconds. Well, got right. So again, few saying true, that you get more opportunities, but most people saying that's false. And absolutely, it is false. As we've already mentioned, the opportunities that we offer learners, we've got the sports clubs for the learners to get involved with, we've got the academic clubs for them to do, we've got the trips for them to get involved with. I think the key difference is that for our learners, we do not make the extracurricular activities compulsory. So they are optional. We highly recommend learners do them. We support them to get involved with the different activities, and we're always encouraging them to diversify their application for university or for apprenticeships and jobs with these experiences. But these are optional for our learners. Next slide, please. Okay, so just quickly, I wanted to talk about student support for learners. So we have lots of different ways that we support our learners here at Harlow College. Star Agency is probably the first department that learners will come into contact with, because it's who you would speak to if you were not a student yet at the college and you wanted to find out more about what we offer. So the Star Agency helps with admissions. They can explain to you what kinds of courses would get you on to particular kinds of careers that you're interested in. And then once you become a learner at the college, they also help the A-level staff with supporting learners with securing their work experience. They support learners with financial support and any travel issues they might have. Bursary is something that is sorted through the Star Agency. So bursary is financial support that you may qualify for that helps with the cost of books and travel and that sort of thing. And this is something that you can discuss with the Star Agency before you become a student here if you're wondering what you might qualify for. Safeguarding is another department that do a wonderful job here at college in ensuring that all of our students are safe and are secure with their well-being. So learners can go to safeguarding themselves voluntarily. Sometimes staff go to safeguarding for advice when we've got concerns about learners. And learners can also go there if they've got concerns about things happening outside of college, maybe with friends or family. And we can support them working with agencies from outside of the college and liaise with them on behalf of the learner. Learning support is something that you might be getting at school and you're worried about whether that's going to continue at college. Absolutely. If you require learning support, we can offer that here at the college. So what we say to learners is declare any learning support you get on your application, and then we can discuss how best to introduce that at college. So that might be, for example, extra time in your exams, you might have LSP support, or it might be on a more pastoral setting. So maybe you're anxious about change and you want some support about integrating into college when you first start. For information about our student support, you can find that on our website. If you contact us, we can discuss that with you further. And we'll also discuss that at interview. Right, so next slide, please. What we're going to do now is we're going to quickly ask you a couple of questions before we get into the Q&A. So we've got a couple of polls that we'd like to do. They're going to appear on your screen now. These polls are totally anonymous. So please get involved with them. They'll take about 30 seconds to answer, and it just gives us a little bit of information about how you feel about what you've seen tonight and about the prospects of applying to the college or coming to the college. So if you could fill those in for us, that would be great. So the first poll, would you say that Harlow College is your first choice, your second choice, your third choice, or you won't be applying for the college, not a choice? Our second poll that we're going to move on to, it is anonymous. And we just ask you, how helpful have you found this session? Has it been very helpful in finding out more about A-levels and coming to the college? Or as we've got there, not helpful at all. Maybe you knew all this information already and we can help you with any extra information you were wanting to find out. If you pop that into the chat question, we can sort that now. So there we go. Right, so let's just have a quick look and see what questions. We've got a couple of minutes left for our questions. So can I combine A-levels at Harlow with the aviation operations course at Stansted? I'm afraid not. That would not be an option. So the aviation operations course at Stansted Airport, that is a full-time program. It's a brilliant program if it's got the progression pathway that you're interested in. So you'd need to either just enroll on that or you just enroll on A-levels. So we do have some learners who are interested in both programs. And as I've said to them at interview, make your mind up when it comes to enrollment, because you might need a bit more time to reflect, see which one is your most preferred course. Is there an opportunity for counsellors at a school for students? Absolutely. We take the mental wellbeing of our students incredibly seriously. So we have, well, when COVID permits, we have counselling sessions that happen here at college. So learners can self-refer themselves for counselling, or they might come to a teacher and ask a teacher to do that for them. So often I fill in the referral forms for learners, and then they can have the counselling sessions here on site, outside of the department, so that they're away from their peers, just so somewhere where they feel safe and secure. Some learners prefer to have the counselling sessions off-site, and we're very lucky to have the centre just behind college where they can have those sessions off-site. We also have a listening service. So these are, they're not counsellors, but they are able to listen to any concerns that learners have. Sometimes learners just need someone to listen to them. If the listening service individuals feel that a learner's concerns are a little bit more serious, they can then refer them for counselling. Do you offer performing arts or drama as an A-level? I'm afraid no, we don't. We don't offer those A-levels. We do have them as vocational programs here at the college. So you can have a look at those to see if you would prefer going down that pathway, but we don't offer those. In the past, where we've had A-level learners who have wanted to go on to courses like drama or performing arts or to performing arts schools after college, it's not actually held them back. In most cases, they're actually being judged on their performance. They'll have to do an audition to get into those. And many of them are involved in clubs outside of college where they do their dance and drama. So it's not hindering their progression. Right, so we are now coming up to 7 o'clock. So we're going to finish this presentation presentation now. If there are any questions still outstanding, we will stay online for a little bit and we will get those answers. So if you've got any more questions, ping those in to us and we will answer those. So thank you so much for joining us today. We hope you've got lots out of this open evening. Don't forget, our applications are open now. As Satiri said, we are doing our interviews every week. So get over to Harlow College, go on to apply online, fill in that application, and then Satiri and I will be doing those interviews with you. We will be dropping you an email with this session recording so you can watch it back again in your own time. And don't forget, you can also download our brand new prospectus. So it is completely digital. It's brilliant. It's got links in it, which will jump you straight to the pages of interest. And you can download it from our Harlow College website. So thank you very much. And we hope you have a great evening.